It's in the email, right, or is it Dropbox?
No, we just want to use the ones that.
Do you want to pull this in?
This one's great, this one's good. No, it's fine. I already wrote that, Zoom days of changing and maybe highlights of what didn't we have.
Okay.
Control slides. So I guess I'm not going to say anything. I apologize for some stuff. I'll go real quick. Basically, full traffic counts. I was trying to get. This major intersection is 0.5 miles, and that has over 100,000 hits, and I have it on the map too.
I would love to be able to take those back from you with any notes that you guys have after this so that we can then use that for our.
Okay, let's go ahead and work through this.
All right,
this is meant to be, once again, it's okay that it's rough, that's not a problem.
This is a rough draft, okay?
Okay.
My name is Maricela Comenta, and we as a team, Juan Maroso, Irene Tamayo, Charlie Merritt, and Alex Arastegui have put together this idea, this concept on a piece of land located in next to the Dolphin Mall. We were approached by the Procacci group to come up with an idea for this piece of land, and a total of 8.13 acres. We researched what was going on in the area, residential, on hotels, and we came up with the numbers. We thought that the best use of that land was to develop a retail mall. We called it Beluga Mall because we think that it should go to an upscale retail line that it's Miami's lacking. We have the numbers of how well this type of mall do in Sawgrass, this is like an outlet mall. It's an upscale off mall that is none in the next. We don't have any in the next within the next 15 miles from Miami. We took advantage. Our total project cost for now it was $47 million, the total cost of the land, and we come up with a cap rate of 7%. Our IRR with a 10-year holding period is 15%, and we used an estimated prices for rental per square feet, calling, getting from the websites, and using like the AK for Simon Properties or Taubman Group. So we compared and got a lot of information, and we get like an average of the numbers that we use. We listed those on the sources. We thought of partnering up with Simon, of course, because of all the advantages that Simon would bring us, bring somebody like that, because that'll give us the lower the risk in terms of they'll bring in the tenants, okay? So our design concept, we discussed and we thought that we are in Miami, a lot of people come to Miami to shop. And so we wanted to take advantage of the open spaces and the air. So we wanted to kind of like a mall with a street-like feeling. At the same time, we wanted to cover it because of the sun and the heat. And we just wanted to give that sense of walking with a family and spending the time of the day there. The architecture in general, the way we visualize, of course, we're going to use sustainable materials. We're going to try to certify either LEED or Green Globe. And we're going to make a combination. We have a couple of ideas like a plastic room. We're going to have a recycled and a room for everything that is recyclable in the mall. This is an idea that a lot of retailers are using, and companies like Simon and Taubman are coming up with different ideas on the recycling basis, and also offering the tenants connections for cars, the electric cars. The way we thought, next, okay. The mall would be on the east side of the piece of land where we decided to go ahead and get some cash from some out parcels. We thought about having a coffee shop up there and a pharmacy. We did the research and we checked that there is a lack of pharmacy within several miles also. And we thought that a coffee shop like Starbucks would serve both the hotel, which is on top of that, and north, and also would attract some of the tenants and the shoppers from the mall. At the bottom, we thought of a Houston type of high-end restaurant that would, of course, be in the corner, and we also attract a lot of people to this. We thought of a different access point to the mall, so you could see it from the way it's designed. It's to attract and to be visualized from the Dolphin Mall, because we want to get that number of people going there. And also, this is a valet parking area. That's an access. That's people coming from here, and from there. We thought, and on the document, we also suggest a couple of things for both for the environment. We're going to offer our tenants on their TI a percentage of sustainability. So if they can come up with something sustainable, we're going to give them more TI. It's going to vary depending on how sustainable they want to be when they build their inside of the stores, because we're shooting for commercial, for retails, need for retails. And as far as the Simon, our possible partner, we thought that they will take an opportunity of competing directly with Taubman, which is, you know, a big hit for them. And they have International Mall, which is in 117th. And we are proposing also to have like a shuttle service from the International to this mall, because there are two different products that they're offering. And it's gonna be like a free shuttle from one place to the other, okay? So that was like a valet and a shuttle entrance, like that is what we're proposing. Okay, so Alex is gonna go ahead and explain the development of the site.
Well, the development side, quick and brief. You guys both know that Dolphin Mall is situated to the left, International Mall is situated to the right. We are 0.55 miles from Dolphin Expressway, which is right.
Just cut off, yeah.
Yeah, it's cut off. And this has the highest traffic count of the area at over 100,000 cars per day. Actually, it's more closer to 200,000. And it's 10 miles, less than 10 miles from Miami International Airport, and it's about 30 miles from Florida International Airport.
The sign itself sits in the surrounding, besides the two big malls, we have a lot of industrial area, but it's starting to change throughout the area. And then our site analysis, this corner right here is where the traffic count camera came in, around 40,000 per day, it was right here. And this is the site that Precocci is going to be building their hotel. So we're going to put the CVS and the coffee shop right here to complement this. And then we wanted the mall to be open and face Dolphin Mall so that it could be seen from the mall itself in the parking lot and areas like that. The demographics for the area, it's pretty much 40 years old is the average age, 46,000 meaning a household, and it's going to be a 7% increase in population for the area over the next 5 years. It's zoned right now as a commercial district, a C2, with 30 height restrictions for two stories, and the site is also contamination free. And then market analysis with more.
So retail in Miami Dade area has picked up recently. There's around 3.5% of vacancy on average rental rates are $31.69. There's a 7% cap rate average. Population has been increasing by 50,000 people per year. The retail inventory currently in Miami-Dade is 124,958,000 square feet in total. There's approximately 1,132,000 square feet under construction. But narrowing it down to where our site is located, which is Sweetwater, we actually have lower vacancy rates compared to Miami-Dade that stand at 2.2%, rental rates are 24.05, which are they coincide with what we're gonna charge our out parcels. The retail inventory that's coming under construction is 73,123 square feet. I have to point out that as Maricela was saying, there is basically no outlet malls in the Miami-Dade area, which is why we're targeting that sector.
Premium outlet.
Premium outlet.
there's a lot of outlet. So market analysis continued. We took a look at Simon Property Group, and we wanted to take a look at what the market was for premium outlets in general. And so, as you can see from the chart on the right here, they have four premium outlets that they're building this year, as well as nine that they're redeveloping. So there's a lot of demand currently for premium outlets, and in fact, one of them is the Colonnade at the Sawgrass, which is undergoing it says 56,000 square foot expansion, but actually that's only Simon's part of it. It's going to be more of a 82,000 square foot total expansion, and so at a cost of $16.9 million. But that $16.9 million is really just for the land to develop. It's another $38 million, and so when we took a look at another $21 million. So when we took a look at our costs, it was pretty comparable per percentage of the size of their footprint that they're trying to build there and what we're trying to build in our area as far as costs go. Additionally, it's also, there's a reason that they're building so many of these. And if you look at the bottom left-hand corner of the earnings release, there's a 11% rate of return that is expected after stabilization for these new development premium sites. And so there's clearly a viable demand for this up. And then Simon Property Group sales in this area, total per square foot, was up 6.4% in 2014. So it's continuing to grow. They're continuing to build more, and there's a demand out there for it. Next slide. So as you can see, so not just a demand, but what's the supply issue here in Miami-Dade? And if you look here, I will put the top left, there's no direct competitors for premium outlets in Miami-Dade. There are premium stores, but they're not outlets, they're not off centers. You're gonna pay full markup price. They're what's in season right now. And so those are mostly located on the areas to the right. And we took a look at 12 different stores and we compared them towards some of the major malls that actually have them. And you can see there, Ball Harbor has the most premium outlets, which would be expected at 75% compatibility. Miami Design District at 50%. And then everything else the Merrick Park, Aventura, and Dadeland only have a 30% or less compatibility. And these, again, are not outlets. They're just direct premium stores. The only one that is a direct competitor would be the Colonnade at the Sawgrass. But as you guys know, that serves a completely different trade market than it does here in Miami-Dade. And so we definitely feel that this is an opportunity. And you can see kind of the miles difference for those different areas.
Go ahead. Don't
look at those too many numbers, please. What we understood from Procacci is that they are a development company that actually hold in a long term. They're not looking to exit upon construction when it finished. And they already have a capital partner lined up to go through this project with them. However, even though they have all of their ducks in the road and they know and they're long-term holders, we strongly believe that by partnering with a company like Simon, will benefit them and bring their risk, their financial risks down. These type of outlet malls or off-limit malls are certain tenants are your target market. So Simon already have them just miles away in Sawgrass, and they're perfectly within the 50-mile radius that these kind of tenants will come down to Miami. So they will bring down potentially their vacancy from 20 to 30% when this project is completed to almost 5 or none, because right now Sawgrass is at 1% vacancy. So we think that it would be a perfect fit. Simon, as we're researching their 10K and their supplemental, they have partnerships in other malls, not only locally, but also internationally. They don't have to be a majority shareholder in a partnership. We think that they don't have to be the developers. They're a great fit for this project to go alongside with Procacci, especially because this project and the land cost is high in relative terms with the construction and what you're going to spend. So you want to minimize the risk as much as possible and lower your vacancy from day one to the bare minimum of 5. This project, we're looking at a 40.
We're looking at around a total project cost of $47 million, with a construction loan of $40 million. We're planning on developing this in an 18-month construction period. Nothing from this slide that we would like to point out is our permanent. Construction loan. Construction loan annual mortgage content, which is at 12%. We're looking at a construction loan cost of around $400,000. Next slide. Here you can see we're calculating our rents with a moderate 2% escalation each year. Our potential gross income starts at around $6,500,000. And in our exit year, we are looking at around $1,300,000 increase. We're dealing with triple net leases, so our operating expenses are going to be passed through. And we're looking at a cash flow before taxes of around $2 million for the beginning, for the first year. And our exit year, we're looking at before cash tax flow of around $3,500,000.
This project, as we said at the beginning, we're looking at a 15% IRR over the 10-year holding period. However, we're revising because we think that it's a little bit lower than that. We're looking at the first year after completion at a 24% IRR. We use a 7% cap rate at this position. We think that that will be in line with potential increase of leverage in the future. We also are looking at a 7% LTV.
1.3 debt service coverage ratio. We're being kind of conservative on what we're looking at.
Another thing that we would like to point out is we're charging in the outlet, the premium outlet malls. We looked at Simon's 8K, and they're charging around $45 a square foot for the rents. So yeah, we forgot to mention that in our. So that's pretty high rent, but that's what we gathered, and that's what Simon charges for stores being in their outlet malls.
So basically, that's based on our financials and all the entire market analysis. We strongly suggest that they entertain a JV with Simon to make this project feasible.
Thank you very much.
Go back to basically your second slide or third slide, which is the development concept slide.
Yeah.
Okay, can you kind of walk us through the bottom two thirds?
What's top secret, but I'll tell you.
Well, no, because the question I have, okay, first of all, just answer, what is the open air market concept? How does that work?
Okay, this is, to leave that for, because I'm assuming that you had read the paper. So if you, it says here, we have a climate canopy covering, yep. This is retail, okay? The retail is pointed out. The red area is retail, and this is the walk like street. This is a valet parking area, and this is also like an open market that we are just proposing, just to promote local artists along with the city of Sweetwater, to make like a community affair, to go to the mall, thinking a little bit ahead of people are, I don't know, internet shopping, they don't want to go to the mall, so to make it more like an experience instead of just going shopping. And also integrate and with the community, the city, and the developer.
I like the concept. I guess my question is, does that, to what extent does that block the visibility of the actual center itself?
No, because this is higher, and this is like something that you can just, it's like a promenade that you can walk, you can set up.
It's like a marketplace.
It's like a marketplace that you can set up by choice. But actually,
it's not permanent.
The view, these are the stores,
right.
And this is a water fountain, okay?
So I guess to better explain it, it's kind of like the Miami Art Miami, that they come once a year. And then they set up in Midtown, and they set up in Wynwood, you know. So we're looking at a concept similar.
A concept similar to that the city can use also, and the owner of the place can also use. This is all parking and parking up there, and you have walking from the inside of the retails, which are here.
What's the size of your boxes there?
5,000 square feet. Each store, we calculated them for 5,000 square feet.
You mean
the
outside
boxes?
We have a Walgreens?
No, your tenants, so you're...
Yeah, 5,000.
Yeah. 5,000.
And there's 20 of them, so...
Yes.
The idea was to have, we compared 12 stores, we're going to have one inline restaurant, and one standalone restaurant, and then
here.
And then seven stores that we're going to try to, mix in with different...
Well, we're calculating the same, because the inline tenants, actually, we didn't, for the restaurant, we didn't calculate exactly, we just put them to pay... which we think is fair, $45 per square foot. Given the numbers that we have from the 8Ks and the 10Ks and the information, we can get somebody that pay even 60. But we just didn't account for that. We just put it as a flat number.
Very simple question. Where does the trash get collected, and where are the deliveries made?
Okay, we have a back area, okay, that this is, like I said, this all area, it's valet, you can walk around, come here, go back here. The we were thinking, and we're adding it, but this is a draft, the box, it's on our concept, it's a room that we're gonna design for just to collect trash and to recycle. And it has to go through the back, okay? So it's gonna be around this area.
Okay. I think it's a really great concept. I had a hard time following it, and I think you guys are on a good concept there if you can kind of illustrate it a little better and I think you cut out the whole part where you talk about blue mall outlets and everything's a little, my left with all that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And kind of blow up that everything you're saying in words, and you can blow up on your
site
map on the right there, and just kind of illustrate it to where, you know, sell me on the picture, sell me on the idea where I look at it and go, oh, you know, maybe when you're retailers, you know, you have a, or I like the sidewalk thing, I like the art, you know, maybe have a picture coming down.
See,
on the side.
There's a climate canopy, okay,
yeah,
that is pointed out here, that discovers all
yeah.
this area.
No,
so.
I think it's great.
Go back,
a
slide.
Following all the lines are kind of difficult.
So you can actually see that canopy.
Yeah. Like,
okay.
Take some pictures
no,
like that and put them, you know,
what
on
he's saying
maybe,
is if you
so
go to the
okay.
previous one, if we remove
take
that,
out, yeah.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
No, we get that.
Yeah,
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 yeah.
Just
yeah.
easier to
We're trying to get a blow up, like a 3D rendering.
Yeah.
We're trying to make it.
Yeah.
I mean, we're not.
I think Google SketchUp.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah,
that's what we're trying to use. Yeah, SketchUp. So
I think we have that as a slide, and then you
exactly.
you have really good ideas, but just sell it on the same slide.
There's still, it's
yeah.
a work.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Just throwing it out there.
I don't know, so yeah, for sure. We're
working on it. Also, we're gonna give colors to the icons, and you know, to go along with the, what they are, because we
yeah,
color
just
them.
Yeah, you have to follow the lines. It, like, it
yeah.
doesn't really sell the story.
Yeah.
Yeah. All I see is a sidewalk, but you have to see a picture of like a Saturday morning art or a green market or whatever you guys have in mind.
Yeah,
you have
hopefully.
To see a picture of it, like the one from the next slide. Yeah. You know, if you have some of those. Yeah, something a little
more visual,
a little sexier than that.
We'll go back to the
which one?
The first line.
First
line. So you could potentially draw something in front
exactly.
of that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Gotcha.
So I can visualize it. You know,
yep. That makes sense.
Okay. Go forward a couple of slides. Right there. So one of the things you probably want to fix before you do your final presentation. Obviously, that color is not going to work for
yeah.
the presentation. So you know, and that's. Obviously, something all you need to think about, because the colors like they look great on the screen,
right.
but then they don't translate well at all, you know, in a presentation environment. So
pastels.
So yeah, be very careful with that, because
if you look at your written handouts,
yeah, written
they were changed. Yeah.
But it's on the presentation.
I know. This is just an older version of this slide.
These are just
yeah.
things for you
yeah.
to be thinking about. Okay,
okay.
Move forward. Another slide. One more. Another one. Keep going. Right there. Personally, I love this one, okay? And what I love about it is the fact that you do go from the general down to the specific. You do, you know, sort of contrast what the differences are. So that part is great. Now, visually, you could probably clean it up a little bit in terms of trying to not necessarily draw arrows, but make sure that what information you're conveying at the national level is roughly on the same line
yeah, so
as what's
yeah,
if
yeah,
it
yeah.
just translates like this, right? That's what you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That would be the only thing
that
I would
sense.
Sort of say, but I love
you mean like line it up.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I don't see anything, for example, you have the Sweetwater Airport West, and I don't see anything about cap rates for that submarket.
There are some that do translate over. You know,
but we can definitely find the average cap rate for it.
Right.
Added here.
I like Dr. Forge's idea, but I guess it's important to have
yeah,
it
you translate.
Three. So there,
you translate.
There's
a slide there. Okay.
Yeah, I like that slide.
I mean, that's
so
the first thing that hits me. I mean, you know,
okay.
the visual looks good, but it's the implementation of
yeah.
of trying to connect the dots, because as a first person, you know, sort of seeing that. Initially, what's going you know through my mind is, okay, how does the national relate to Miami-Dade? How does that then relate to Sweetwater? And
yeah.
you know, doing that for virtually each variable, realizing yeah, you may not have every piece of information for every level, but to the extent that you do, it's probably a good idea that you line them up.
No, we can probably find
yeah.
it. I mean, that's
no,
good.
No, we'll do it.
Yeah.
Okay.
What else?
Obviously, the next page, the market analysis page,
yeah.
way too much information
yeah, yeah.
there.
Oh,
you
yeah.
need to get that. Obviously fixed. The next one I liked. I think I like the graphic on the map. I think that's a great way to show the
competition.
The competition. So I think yeah, you did a great job with that one. Obviously, the financial analysis, you've already
yeah.
you
yeah,
know
yeah,
what
yeah.
you need to do there
yeah.
in terms of
yeah.
too much information. Just get it down to the key pieces
yeah.
of information. That you know, it's sort of question. Okay, is do I really need to see all of that?
No,
you know,
no.
is that a slide that
yeah.
I could get rid of?
Yeah.
and make it just into a couple of words. And so, I mean, I think overall, yeah, I mean.
And the JV proposition, we need to.
I'm sorry?
Yeah, we should need a slide with a JV proposition. Why we're proposing a JV.
Yeah.
And how it's going to
be
structured.
Structure.
That wasn't a draft, but we didn't have time to finish it because we had another presentation to do today.
Okay. All right. No, overall, though, I mean, I think, you know, good job. I think it looks good. So, okay, you guys. All right. So, let's open up for a few minutes from you guys in terms of your thoughts.
Thank you.
I thought it was.
Oh, okay.
We're not done.
Information there. Like you said, there's some slides that were just overwhelming.
Yeah, it was a little bit. Some were just like.
There's just too much information.
Oh,
it's
good.
All the right information, but it's something that, that's something that you can simplify and elaborate without having it up there.
I like the concept of, you know, the design and how, you know, how they want to be bigger now. They just want to complement the other malls and the shuttle and, like, you know, come into the community and they get very, you know, close to the community like that.
I thought the detail on the market analysis for premium outlets versus premium stores was really crucial. And that map there was excellent.
Yeah.
The one on the right, perfect.
Anybody else? Okay.
No, I just had a question. I love
Please.
That area as well. My question is in regards to the layout itself. On the handout you gave us, should we follow that pattern or just we pull up what we feel is important for projector?
You're going to have to make judgment calls as to what, you know, will fit within kind of that format and what doesn't. But what I'm trying to convey with that format is you don't want to overwhelm people with so much information on the side they can't follow it. They can't see it. They can't read it. You know, those are the things you just have to keep in mind. You know, so it's just a but, you know, you can always refer back to page 12 of our written handout as this detail. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
Oh, hope.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Actually,
we can go through
it. It's only doing
it. The first. Oh, you already have it?
No, I can pull back up.
No, we can just go through it later.
That's
no,
it's all right.
No, we'll pull it up.
We'll pull it up. Give me a second.
It's like 5 o'clock. This is
okay. Hope.
Pretty.
Captain.
Hot.
We just got a few more notes from that.
This one?
We can start there. Yeah. And so it's not all over the place. All right, so I guess we can start from the beginning, just go really quick. But the next slide. Yeah. I mean, there's got to be a way to get that a lot simpler.
Yeah.
There's so much on there that I don't know where to start looking at it. And then the next slide, if you talk about the LEED certification, I know you mentioned it in the highlights there. I don't see anything reflected in your financial analysis and the impact.
We added a premium to the construction cost when we were calculating, because we're going to go for LEED for commercial interiors. We're not going to certify the just for commercial interiors. So that's why I explain about the TI allowance. It's like an incentive plan for the tenants. If they want to get more TI, they have to give a percentage of sustainability, but that is not accounted for as a specific number on the finance. It's explained on the summary.
Okay. And have you guys researched the impact of how tenants, retailers look at lease certification?
Yes, definitely. Simon is one of the ones who's really moving forward. It's on the corporate projections now. They are the ones that have actually that plastic room in now in 3 or 4 of their current projected malls,
yeah.
And also the electric car connections they're offering for free. I mean, in a lot of places.
You just add another bullet saying, you know, specifying that tenants are looking for lease certification now or.
Tenants are not looking for per se, but corporations like Simon and Taubman are competing for that.
Yeah. And I forgot to mention too, on the development concept, the map data, like the shuttle idea. And if you can emphasize that,
the canopy, you mean, or
the shuttle.
The shuttle from wall to wall.
Emphasize, show on the map. Or show.
Oh,
on
that a shuttle is coming from the international mall?
Yeah,
okay.
It'd be nice to sell that feature. Right now everyone's at the walkability and whatnot, so that's a big selling feature. And then on the map, the next page, you guys have mentioned it, but to see it on the map, the traffic count, specify how much, maybe some information you had on the first slide,
about
the Dolphin Mall, how much money spent, how many visitors they have, any information you can throw on that map,
mm-hmm.
that's relevant, obviously.
Okay.
Show how far you are from Miami Airport, just have an arrow pointing to Miami International.
Kind of like how about the other map, where it's kind of, like on this one?
Yep.
Wherever it is.
Yep.
Kind of like this?
Yeah.
Even it just goes straight up, like off to the picture?
Yeah, you can just throw like 20, yeah, mm-hmm. Perfect, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. I think you have mentioned some really good things, but sometimes people listen to what they want to listen to and see what they want to see. So.
Yeah, I also forgot to mention that FIU and the Miami-Dade Fair are right, like, in this area on the map.
Yeah. I feel like on a map, you can show a lot more.
Would it be better to say zoom out and try and capture FIU down here and just still have this highlighted, but maybe kind of smaller and try and
But then again, how relevant is FIU to this project?
For students and co.
It's like right here, like Smiley Day Fair, so it's just amount of the students and.
No, just see
the. What you said before is an arrow pointing.
That's fine. Let's do an arrow.
Just selling it,
just to get
Even though you may not have any students from FIU come visit, it's still sell the feature. The market analysis, I think, is good. I don't know how necessary that,
We went through that. We're not going to put it.
You're gonna take
we
that.
Just put this. Yeah, we're gonna, we're going to simplify.
And then the numbers, I guess, revisit the numbers to make sure they're going to probably. There's going to be somebody sitting there. I guarantee it. On that panel, he's going to be a numbers guy. He's going to go through every single number.
We're not going to give him that much to think about. We're going to just...
in your book, too, so just make sure to revisit the number. I know, for example, just off the bat here, the loan, the loan cost of, 12.7 seems a little high. I think you can, this project doesn't really sound feasible right now the way you have it, but I think you can tweak it and to make it a little more feasible and a little more attractive. You can bump up your escalations from 2% to 3%, lower your loan cost in. Just little things that you can do that are very reasonable and normal assumptions.
It's kind of why I brought up the colonnade, because we are in that ballpark.
Yeah.
When you're talking apples to apples,
mm-hmm.
it's like you said, though, tweaking it just a little bit to make sure that it's the right number, but we're definitely in the ballpark.
I think you said maybe 15% return or something, but I don't think any developers are going
to... Well, the thing is that when we had this discussion with Alex, we throw some numbers, out of the napkin, and I told him that this is not like a really good. I mean, it doesn't really matter what you do.
Yeah.
It's you pay a lot for that.
I mean, yeah, of course.
I mean, it's a hard
basis.
Project.
It's a challenge.
It's a challenge. Yeah. It's a challenge.
If it was easy, he would have done himself.
Exactly. So, if you try it, I think that if it's 16-17% return IRR it should be served.
Right.
Because it's but we get your
And are you guys selling our parcels to
they don't want to.
They don't want to sell it.
That's something that I ask.
Yeah.
To improve the IRR, of course, if you finish the construction and you sell the parcels and you stay with them all.
Right now you're seeing Walgreens and Starbucks trade everything.
They when we had the meeting, he said they want to hold everything. They don't want to sell anything. Yeah. So we just geased.
I tried.
Starbucks was like a 20-year lease.
And he said, don't forget, we're not there.
Starbucks was a 20-year lease with a 10-year as the renewal.
Who does?
Starbucks. Yeah, they're known for doing the 20-year leases. So it was fair to lease it and hold it until.
I'm trying to think of ways to bump up the.
Selling the
that
was our first thought, to sell up
the
airport.
And then the last, those charts at the end there are probably.
They're not going.
But other than that, it looked really good. I think that's a good idea.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you for that.
Okay.
thing for the groups, if you go present yourself individually and say, my name is so-and-so, I'm, you know, tell them what you're doing right now, a brief summary about yourself, and then maybe your what you're going to be doing, a part that you presented or the part that you worked on. I worked on the market analysis, and I'll, this is a very, very brief description of everybody who each person is.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Kathleen Mitchell. This is our group Five Star Development. I am a third quarter student here at NOLA, and I'll introduce the rest of the team, introduce themselves. I worked on the site analysis and the regulatory and chipped in with some of the marketing.
Good afternoon, my name is Laura Lopez. I am currently a paralegal. This is my second quarter in the program. I worked on this site analysis and marketing analysis.
Good day, everyone. My name is Olivia Roberts. This is my first semester in the program. And I worked with economic analysis and chipped in with a little bit of the marketing and overall everything else.
Hello, my name is Janae Valentine. I'm a second quarter semester here at Nova Southeast University. And I really focused on the marketing portion, but also dabbling a little bit in outside resources that we used, such as styles.
Hello, my name is Daryl Blue. I'm a third quarter student in the program, and I work in real estate marketing. I worked on the financials piece of the project today, and I'm going to explain to you financial analysis.
Basically, as when we were thinking about our group and what we really wanted to accomplish with this project is, we really wanted to develop a sustainable project that had lucrative financial returns to investors and the municipality. That's very important. We also wanted to create significant job growth in the local community, particularly Sweetwater. In summary, we're capturing the demand for high-end retail needs in Western Miami-Dade County. We're building an autoplex. We're partnering with Bremen Miami Motors, and we'll do two luxury brands at that autoplex, BMW and Cadillac. We also are creating on one of the parcels a retail shopping center to capture the increased spending power of the middle and upper class local residents and overseas tourists. The shopping center will feature high-end brands that cannot be found in Dolphin Mall nor International Mall. And this project will be completed in 24 months, and we are charging Bremen a 3% developer's fee to build the autoplex. And the shopping center will be retained by Pocachi and produce lucrative IRRs.
Can I quickly just hit in the PowerPoint slideshow?
It's not open.
It's
the bottom
right.
Is that?
It's the online.
Because it's on the Dropbox.
You download it.
What's that?
You download it to desktop.
It's just really small.
I think it's the way we say it.
Go to open.
That's what I did first.
Go over. Oh. So I know. So it's download.
If you go out, back out to the folder and then right click on the file, it'll give you an option to download. And then you can just open it directly. Right click on the file name. Yep, right there. Hit download. Thank you.
bottom. Thank you. Basically, the regulatory for this is Zone C2, Special Commercial District. These are just generic statements about the regulatory. You have to consider landscaping, height restrictions, particularly parking requirements for our retail component, and we're having restaurants, so we really have to pay special attention to the parking because we had a mix of restaurant space and just regular shopping space. Those are our three parcels. Total is 8.132 acres. One of the main strengths of the site is accessibility. The Florida Turnpike and Dolphin Expressway are main arteries that connect the immediate Miami-Dade County and Southern Florida area. Our location is here, and we can access it from these major arteries. Also on this map, a little hard to read, but it are the traffic counts, and you'll see higher traffic counts right here off the Florida Turnpike. This is a very strong retail area. It's in the Airport West submarket. The Dolphin Mall and the International Mall are in very close proximity. The Miami Airport submarket experienced unprecedented growth in retail sales in 2014. Continued growth is projected in 2015. So here's our site, Turnpike. Just one thing we found out was this Best Buy location is one of the top performing stores for Best Buy in all of Florida. So when we were thinking about our retail component, we definitely need to have some type of electronics. Also, we have an analytics chart. You can see in 2014 the growth in retail sales, how it's jumped. And for 2015, it looks on pace to be just about what it was in 2014. Some of the weaknesses, city of Sweetwater. Demographics don't support our product. The median household income for the city of Sweetwater is only $33,000. This demographic spending power is not in line with our retail products. However, the project will provide jobs for residents in the immediate area. The second weakness of the site is the numerous industrial warehouse buildings and vacant land surrounding our location. If you ever have driven the area, it looks kind of desolate, and you might not want to go there at night by yourself. And these two locations are right along Northwest 110th Avenue. This is actually a warehouse staging area, and that's actually a warehouse. Now I'll turn it over to Laura to explain our whole site.
Okay, so this is where we're gonna put the Autoplex along Northwest 14th Street and 110th Avenue corner. We will have one structure, two showrooms. This is gonna be a Raymond BMW showroom and Raymond Cadillac showroom. They are going to share a sixth floor garage that's gonna serve for inventory. We're gonna have some inventory in the front. The perimeter is gonna have greens, shrubs, and palm trees. Then we're gonna share our parking spaces with our plaza. This is gonna be our plaza. We're gonna have high-end stores here, two restaurants, Bonefish Grill, with Chris. We're gonna have a fountain, two entry points, one here on this side, and then we're gonna have one here. They're not shown here, but that's what it's gonna be. We're gonna have the service road that's gonna end lead to the hotel that's being built at the end of, on the other side of our site. All right, so the other place we feature, both showrooms will be 50,000 square feet. The garage building is 6 stories, and the facilities will be located on opposite sides of the garage. The total buildable garage area is 67,783. We have reserved 10,000 to accommodate infrastructure, bathrooms, elevators, stairways, and other common areas. Next.
That's a floor plan.
That's a floor, yeah. this is what it's going to look like, the Raymond BMW side. And this is the Cadillac, the look everyone has. The interior of the showrooms will be a modern open floor concept. Each room will have sales area, financing area, front desk, gift shop, and cafe waiting area, and a juice bar. We just want to make it a comfortable experience for someone, for the customers that are going to come in. They're going to be there for a few hours, so we know it's going to be a long day for them. We're going to want to have a good environment inside the showrooms. We're going to have different features for them. And then we're going to have, this is the open floor area where the sales center is going to be. And this is like a waiting room, waiting area where the cafe and the juice bar is going to be. Okay, so now the shops are going to be a total of 31,600 square feet. Our target market is high-end retail shops. The stores will lease spaces at two stores like Tory Burch, Ferragamo, Gucci, Lacoste, among others. The two brands that will be leasing the restaurants, like I said before, will be Ruth Chris Steakhouse and Bonefish Grill. And these are the logos of the stores. We're gonna also gonna have an Apple store as well, because we want to put some technological, aspect into the plaza. Okay, then we have Janae going to present our marketing now.
Yes, besides the incorporation of Autoplex as a creative element to our project, the reason why we came to that number was because in, I'll go in further detail later, but in the area, auto sales is the highest and then follows clothing retail. But as far as the metropolitan overview, here's just a view of the Miami-Dade area, the surrounding cities. As we mentioned, Sweetwater is not the highest income as far as median household, but the surrounding areas, especially I want to highlight Doral, they have a really good medium household income, and we think that the surrounding cities will be able to complement our idea of a higher end legacy plaza. So for the city of Sweetwater, here's just a breakdown. Like I explained, the income, the household income isn't as high, but there is a lot of auto sales there, specifically 1 mile of Sweetwater, but then 5 miles out is a substantial growth, as well as clothing. Okay, and so for our Miami retail market, it's continuing to be an upward trend. We took a look at CBRE, and for the average asking rate in Miami, we found that the retail for that was $44.96 per square foot. And also,
we use CBRE.
Yeah. And as vacancy rates decrease, rental rates increase, and the job market is overall stabilizing. So we think those factors will definitely help our high-end audience. Okay, also we found that since we're in such, we're in Miami, it's a very high populated tourism place, so we thought that we would incorporate, aspects of a higher brand that might appeal to travelers. So that's where we really got our brands from. And also you notice here that Miami is the third largest market for retail after New York and Los Angeles. So that's how we pretty much came to the agreement that retail was the highest and best use for our site. So why our luxury brands is because, as we mentioned before, there's not a lot of high-end brand from International Mall or Dolphin Mall surrounding it. So we feel like this was an opportunity for us to get in the market. Also, the surrounding cities, we believe, can help with the overall cost offsetting and our tourism market.
Okay, so basically for the economic analysis, the conceptual plan proposed by Five Star Development was to enhance the development of Sweetwater.
Overall factors included, as again, we focus on Raymond, which is one of the top retail car dealerships. Tourism factors, looking at import and export of cars, and as well as creating jobs. Now, the jobs that were created, it started from construction to the completion of it. And what we noticed is that what we were trying to focus is keep all of the income growth for these jobs in the city of Sweetwater, and basically attracting, making it a highly visible location. So one of the things I was also covering was why Raymond. Raymond is ranked as the top luxury car dealership in South Florida. It was established for more than 32 years. And one factor is immediate purchase to export, and export providing access to the fastest production vehicle in the world. As far as all of my calculations with jobs that will be produced, I also use CBRE and a little bit of CoStar with assistance from my colleagues. It was like 2,200 jobs in the Western Miami-Dade between commencement and development. This includes 1,600 jobs directly created as a result from the construction work into the site, 700 jobs created through indirect and induced effects from the construction site, another 1,100 jobs created when employment increased the household spending patterns, and 2 million will be generated through direct spending with the construction. The materials and services that will be obtained, which was a good factor, is from outside of Miami-Dade and imported. So therefore, we are experiencing a little bit of leakage in funds with the investment.
Okay, so some of these numbers I'm gonna have to go back and work on, but the property value for the retail center was $14,471,000, about $14 million, with the NOI of $2 million a year. We was told that these construction loans for this type of property are usually pretty favorable, and we can get them at about a 2.5 interest rate and a 75% loan to value ratio. That came from a source at Comerica Bank, who provides local construction loans. With a person like Brayman, having being credit worthy and having reputable transactions in the area, they're able to get that financing at that price. Here's a construction schedule of both of our properties. First one was the Legacy Retail. It has about a 2-year construction period. That one we were going to start just shortly after the Autoplex, which has about a year and a half construction period. The total construction cost for both sites was about $81 million, and this is just how we were going to break the financing down in the first 3 years, starting in 2015 and ending in 2017. It was about 374 working days for the first parcel, the Autoplex, and 513 working days for the second parcel. And this is just our deal structure. Once again, don't pay attention to the numbers, but it was about the 75% loan to value ratio, and we brought in a private equity investor to fund 10% of the construction and permanent loan, and Prakashi, the developer, was going to fund the other 15% with land acquisition, or the land and additional cash on cash funds. This is just the percentages here. The capital sources for land acquisition was about 13%, debt interest during construction 2%, and construction cost 85%. These are some of the assumptions we use. Retail shell build out was about $125 per square foot, tenant allowances of $100 per square foot. Rents were about $34 and had 3% rent bumps. Autoplex sale, the sale of the Autoplex after construction. We were going to sell the Autoplex and hold the retail center. The sale of the the sale of the autoplex per square foot was $300, and the overall project yield came out to about 7.19%, developer IRR of 11%, private equity investor 8%, and a total unlevered IRR of 19.5%. For the retail parcel, it was 79,000 square feet of space. At $33 per square foot times the leasable area, we were getting about $2.6 million of profits from each one. And these are the project cash flows down here at the bottom. First 3 years are negative for the construction cost. And then this here is the sale of the autoplex. Then these following cash flows are for the retail lease. These are just our debt summaries and exit cash flow strategies. I told you the developer IRR was about 11% and private equity fund about 8%.
That's our conclusion, so we'll open it up for any questions.
Okay. You want to start
this on? Sure. Okay, it's already beginning. Coming down to the end there, I kind of understood kind of your business plan and what your proposal was, but maybe at the beginning we can specify exactly what you guys had in mind. So it sounds like you're staying in as a developer at a very minimal fee, and then you're going to sell off the complex in, I think, year three or two or something like that. Maybe up front, you can let me know exactly how you see this going through for the next few for the whole period. Also, if and I'm not sure, I guess the last group mentioned that Alex and Akasha was looking to sell this. So, I mean, right there, that alone might be something you might get knocked on for going against what was specified in the documents or whatever was provided.
No, I said develop the sale.
We were struggling with that, and we looked at the list, and they said you could hold or sell. So
okay.
We decide to balance it out. We'll sell the autoplex because most autoplex.
Because what I was thinking is maybe doing a few different exit options and do like a sensitivity analysis and saying, well, here's one option where if you hold the autoplex, here's an option if you sell it in year five.
Well, the thing was, most autoplexes don't lease the owner.
Yeah.
And no construction lender would give us funding to do an autoplex unless we had a buyer in mind and already had some type of contracts with them saying that they were going to occupy that land.
Yeah, that was one of my questions. I know Grayman doesn't ever lease land or anything like that. And that development fee, you might want to call Alex and confirm that 3% is okay with them.
We discussed that with him.
Yeah.
And he actually, that was one of his numbers he came up with.
Okay. All right, so if we go, keep going through it there. The regulatory, get a slide.
Thanks, man.
I don't know how necessary it is to really keep that, maybe throw it in somewhere else, but to keep a whole slide about, I mean, the panel's going to assume that you did your due diligence and that whatever you're doing is legally permissible. So to kind of spend, I know you only have a limited, 20 minutes, so to spend time specifying what's approved for the site, I think they're going to give you the benefit of the doubt, unless you.
Yeah, I think the only thing I would say is anything that is non-conforming mm-hmm. with the existing zoning or regulations, then you would certainly want to include that, or but otherwise, probably in the presentation portion, probably not.
And then all your maps and images, if you can scroll them up, because I
just
put
the slide of it, so you can see
images and whatnot. And the sourcing, I think I saw a chart, no, I think it's the third one there. Keep going.
Yeah. This.
Okay.
This.
Skipped it. Yeah, I don't know. Maybe there's a source there, but the source in the chart is wherever you got your data from there.
CoStar. That one's CoStar.
Oh, okay.
But I guess we can write
it. Does it say it? Or?
No.
No. Okay. I think it's cut off.
I know my eyes are bad.
No, it's not here.
And then the part with the weaknesses, I mean, remember we're trying to sell this to the panel, so I know it's a good thing to know. It's really good to get to the SWOT analysis to decide whether or not it's, you know, where your weaknesses lie. And it's great to know because if they question you, you can have that in the back of your head. But I would recommend taking that out and kind of, you know, you're trying to sell this to them. So letting them, maybe they don't think of it. Maybe, you know, it's not a sketchy way of looking at it. It's just, realistically speaking, maybe they don't see that as a weakness. So I don't think it's necessary to.
It's on the paper because we have to do it, right? But now we know we only need to have 10 slides.
Do you think, though, that it's a good idea to show that you're very thorough?
I think in your paper.
Like a thorough process, like you're not recognizing the fact that there are some weaknesses to the.
I think you bring it up in the paper, but I mean, if I'm trying to sell you my car, am I going to tell you, well, you know what, the other day I ran over something.
No, but I mean, if you're going to sell me your house, you're going to tell me that the plumbing has had issues.
I mean,
they gave us a list of things that we need to talk about, so that's why we included
it. It is, but I think, I don't know, for me personally, I think that it says that it was very well thought out. Like, you're not, and I know what you're saying, if you back it up in the paper.
You're not selling it, right.
But just to point it out, to say, well,
based on
this
that,
may be your weakness, but this is how we're going to overcome
it. Based on that weakness, I'm saying, well, I don't care if I'm generating more jobs for the economy. If you're telling me that, I think somewhere in there you mentioned something about how
industrial.
It's not really, what is it?
Northwest 110th Avenue, it's dark at night, it's more industrial land.
Yeah, it says this demographic spend power is not in line with our retail products. So maybe you state the weakness and then you figure a way to mitigate the weakness and say, well.
Yeah, that's what I said. I said, but that will be the employment opportunities for this.
Well, I mean,
that's not.
And there's no question. There's be a difference of opinion about this. Mm-hmm. I mean, I would probably tend to say, put the weaknesses in the paper,
not
not necessarily in the presentation.
Okay.
The presentation is supposed to be kind of upfront, basically, it's a once again more of a sales and a story, as opposed to really getting into the weeds of the deal.
We were just trying to do our presentation based on what was required in
on
the paper and mirror it.
And
but you're
I
saying
think,
just
I think
kind of
some
sweeten
your,
it up and
you know,
make it look a
and
little.
80% of should be a mirror, but then there's maybe 20% that you kind of have to
like
sort of
the regulatory,
say.
Regulatory.
Don't need to put
weaknesses,
in there.
Yeah,
things like
you
that.
Really need
okay.
to put that in the actual presentation itself.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. Got it.
Now, once again, as Glenn said, you need to be aware of it so that if someone were to ask you. Well, you've given me this glossy presentation about how great this is. What are the downsides?
Right. Yeah.
Then you would obviously, the door has been opened for you to
talk about the area, the demographics, pursue. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, instead of emphasizing on the weakness there, saying the demographics spending power is not in line with our retail product, maybe you said, although the demographics spending power is not in line with our retail, we can draw from secondary and tertiary markets. And you know give numbers for those Doral and that.
But I think we were just scared that if we didn't say something,
yeah,
they'll be like, well, why? How could you put luxury there and that the market doesn't support that? You know, like we didn't want to say crazy.
Here's the thing. there's a significant amount of this that's always going to be open to interpretation.
Right.
As I said, six different judges potentially are going to have six different ideas as to what you may do or not do and what's right or not right. But as a general rule, you know, what we're trying to kind of, you know, say, let's sort of get it to the, you know, to what extent possible, keep it somewhat
positive. Yeah,
it's kind of cherry pick.
You may have one person in the group that's like, all this is fluff. None of this is, you know, reality. But yet you have another person that would be, well, why are you talking all this negative stuff? You know, like
I'm really bad. I'm like Dustin. I'll tell you everything that comes to mind. And I'm a horrible salesman. Like I'm not in the sales business on purpose because I'm horrible.
Yeah,
at it.
So
but at some point, you know, you got to know your audience and know what you're up there for. And again, my recommendation is to mitigate. You know, show how you're going to fix the weakness.
If we discuss it.
Yeah, and as we said, you know, chances are the feedback that you get from the judges could be in total diametrically opposed to what we're telling you. Hopefully not.
It's just creeping up. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, it's good.
Thank
you. You know.
I won't be the least bit offended if you take zero about what I say, but.
No,
so,
I think I'm with you now. Take it out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so the next slide real quick on the site plan. One thing that just pops into my head, I guess I'm obsessive about this, is the visibility of that back piece of the retail. That to me, it gets sort of, in other words, there's no real, at least line of sight. That, I mean, that if you're coming from this way or even coming from this way, I mean, how much of a line of sight are you gonna have into that, you know, from just a visibility perspective? Is it gonna be kind of hidden behind this? So if somebody's coming down this thoroughfare, you know, are they gonna see it? I don't know, you know, that would be something. I mean, obviously at this point, it's probably too late to be, you know, rearranging your site, but I think I would at least think about, well, what would be your answer to that? If someone were to say that I think that's a problem.
I would say we're gonna put a big a billboard right on the road here with, you know, advertising the plaza, that billboard. I mean, just so that they can see it from the turnpike and they can see it from.
But also from the turnpike, we'll stage billboards far south to Homestead, directing them to the restaurants.
Market the property.
I have a suggestion for you on that one. The, the Dolphin Mall color, it looks like it was water. I had, like, when you first brought it up, it took me a little to figure out, like,
it looks like sand
and water. I don't know.
It kind of looked like
the
beach.
Colors, or like
the
beach.
Okay.
And then the landscape's green.
Yeah, then you know, because it took me a second, and I've looked at these pictures a lot. Obviously, we all have, but it took me a second to kind of, like, figure out where's the front, where's the back.
Okay.
I thought that was water. So, I mean, I figured it out, but
this
is a suggestion.
We knew we weren't on the coast.
Not this guy either.
The other thing is just kind of tighten up on your market research, your rents. I know the last group said something about $25 a square, but I don't know exactly how much retail is right now in that submarket, but you guys mentioned 40-something and then coming down. You came down, I think you ended up beating 32 or so. But what's going to happen is all three groups are going to present on the same exact product. And if one group's saying 25, the other's saying 32, it's going to bring a red flag to any
I mean, we have charts from CBRE. That's where we got it from.
Yeah, I mean, so that's kind of macro. Those charts are of Miami-Dade in general. That's including Coral Gables, Brickell, Wynwood, Sign District. So if you hone in, like the last group did the great job of showing, okay, this is national, this is Florida, or however they did it, Miami-Dade, and then if they got into the actual submarket. And that's the part that's, I think, the most relevant is getting into the
market. Can you go to our slide with the market in there?
Well,
we
just don't have everything here.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. I think we use CoStar for the rental rates for Dolphin,
this
International Mall. They were $25, $26 per square foot.
The next one.
We're doing premium brand, luxury brands.
We didn't put it in,
so
we're
going to have higher finishes, so we bumped it up.
Yeah.
The previous group was outlet brand,
so
we're
going to
have an actual Gucci store, not a Gucci outlet. So that's how
we're going to do it.
On CoStar. CoStar, it's 25, 26 for Dolphin and International. That was the average price per square foot for those two malls. But those are, you know, your Gaps, your other lower end brand stores. We're doing.
It'd be interesting to see what the Colonnade in Sawgrass. They have all the high end, like you guys, the Gucci and the Ferragamo. It'd be interesting to see.
So use that as a comp for our rates. Okay.
You know, that's the closest thing to
Ball
what.
Ball Harbor. I was thinking Ball Harbor, but then.
Ball Harbor, yeah.
The different,
that's
completely different market. I mean, this.
Yeah.
The inline tenants pay a lot more. The problem with taking the aggregate of Dolphin is they do have like Sears and Macy's, and they totally destroy
the.
The
comps. And on top of that, they charge a percentage of the sales.
Right.
So when you use that number or those low numbers, you usually get a percentage of the sale.
Mm-hmm. On top of that,
and usually says undisclosed. So
yeah,
you have to play with the numbers.
Thanks for the
we put that in there, 5% retail cost.
Yeah.
Of the
you
sale.
Put that
okay.
Because it's not disclosed on.
Oh, you put percentage rent in there.
Yeah, it was on one of the slides.
Oh,
okay.
Good.
Yeah, the economic analysis slide, I think. I mean, as many of them, just need to be streamlined. Like Dr. Ford, you mentioned before, just keep it very simple and to the point, like,
numbers.
And especially the next one after that, it just,
And once again, I'm really questioning those numbers about the job creation, and I'm not sure what that's based on, but that, I mean, just at first glance, that you're somehow creating 2,900 jobs by virtue of this little project, doesn't pass the sniff test.
Because we're not doing only direct, we're doing indirect, so maybe we should just focus on just the direct.
Just the direct. So what's your, you can expand, Olivia, but she basically was talking about even job creation, I think you mentioned.
Internationally.
But should we focus on the actual product and the people working there full time? Should we include construction jobs?
I would try to do a little bit of both. In other words, I would try to really sort of say on-site.
Before.
Temporary jobs?
Yeah,
temporary, part-time.
And then your permanent jobs would be the retail, car dealerships, but yeah, your numbers there are you know, you see a lot of huge projects right now that are going on in Coconut Grove and the Gables. You don't see that kind of job creation.
Right.
You
want
to, double
we'll
check.
We'll cite our sources for those. We'll make sure.
And then I like the construction schedule a lot, wherever it is.
It's Project Pro.
Yeah, that's great, but I can't see any of it.
maybe
just leaving out the details. Again, maybe
it's a great thing for the written presentation, not so much for the visual presentation, unless you have a really nice timeline that you could put up on one slide.
Yeah, we do, but it doesn't expand.
Yeah, and so I would just say stick it in the paper.
Yeah, and then just tighten up check those numbers and make sure that, I know you mentioned to not pay much attention to the numbers, so I try not to. But I am a numbers guy, so I
can't
help but yeah.
Well, can I ask you, are those construction lending numbers that I had, are those pretty much like?
I thought they're a little optimistic, but I know like the debt service at 0.75, but again, I'm not Raven, so I probably won't get.
Well, they told me it was like LIBOR plus 240 basis points or something.
Yeah, so
LIBOR is like 0.18 or
something. Yeah, so that'd be 3 point something. I think you had 2.5 in there.
2.5.
Yeah, so you might want to bump that up a little. I think you had, just, a lot of preliminary. I know I'm not going to.
Somewhere.
Yeah.
I think it was 2 up.
So with that being said, too, because this is about my question, I should work in relation to the amount of time frame this complex is taking, how long it's taking to be built. So the longer it takes to be built, the more employees you need to hire, right?
Well, it's still going to take the same guy to do,
I was looking at like people who are, because it's going to be sustainable, but looking at people who are focused on different sectors, like their experience here or, that's what I all incorporated in there.
Okay, go.
So.
Oh, sorry.
No.
So what's
my question is, should I incorporate that with him? Basically, the amount of time needed when it's being built. Should I just...
For example, your concrete guy, I mean, it's going to be one, whether it takes you 3 years to do it or 3 months, it's still going to be one job.
It's going to cost more.
The cost.
Yeah.
And so, on this particular slide, I know you said to ignore the numbers, but I can't ignore the debt service coverage ratio is below one. Obviously, it has to be above one in order to pay your debt service. So what's
So the debt wasn't the correct number, so
okay.
I threw it off.
All right.
Yeah.
This is just
for the retail. We don't have like two separate debt services yet.
Just to give you a ballpark, so when you're doing your numbers, you double check it. Just you want to be at least 1.4 or so, and maybe that's just to give you an idea of
Should be double that, pretty much,
or
close to double.
And is this a construction
loan
or the permanent
loan? It's just one.
Permanent.
You won't have a debt service coverage ratio on
construction loan, right?
You don't pay any interest.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. There's one page. I don't remember where it is, but you have the population of Miami-Dade is about 2 billion instead of 2 million.
Oh, it's 2 billion? I'm sorry, I thought it was 2 million.
Clearly, right there.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Sorry. Okay. Thanks for catching that.
Right, but they have that population. That
yeah. Little, right?
The entire country.
Anybody else from the other groups? Comments? Okay.
The slide that goes back to the layout of the actual thing.
Yep.
You guys mentioned, I saw that you had a shielded part where that was only going to be cars. And then was there a mention that they were going to be cars for sale on in the shared parking lot? And is that okay? Because that sounds really weird to me to have like
no,
cars.
No, we're only going to have our inventory in the garage, and then we're going to have a few cars.
Like display.
The display.
Right, the display's on that side, not on the opposite side.
No, okay. This is to share. This is for customers and for the plaza.
It was said that most dealerships in South Florida look for the garage because it protects from like severe weather and hurricane season.
Right.
So they don't want their cars out in the parking lot like you traditionally see. They want the garage more.
I would agree with that.
And then in the parking ratios, you know, we had to do that because we needed enough parking for at least for the plaza. I mean, for both, but for the plaza more than anything.
And since we are a car dealership, we also thought about the shuttle service to get around the whole two parts into the hotel as well.
All right. Anybody else?
You guys did a good job of presenting. We seem very comfortable. So that's a good
talk. Oh, thanks.
You practiced my 5 times.
Yeah, I hate all these people.
Okay. I think, you know, it's going to be an estimate. But I mean, 2,900 is nowhere close. Maybe 290.
You're building a lake.
They don't have an actual PowerPoint presentation. Comments on it.
I don't know the answer, I'm not.
I mean, at this point, I don't think anybody's going to be able to do a wholesale renovation of their project.
No, you know what we just said, though? What's great is that every group has a different concept. So it's pretty, it's not like, you know, where everyone got that, you know, the warehouse, or like, what do we do?
The luxury stuff is not enough.
All right, so our site is located between.
Yeah, it's 5.5 miles.
I think we should just say the concept.
Yeah,
we should just pull up the model and say the concept.
Did you tell us how terrible the idea was? Is that what all that red is in that picture? There's so much in here. He killed us. Might as well just give up now.
It's actually just like cupcakes.
Oh, that's a good one.
Yeah, dude, you're getting fancy with that.
We spelled Pikachu.
I like the other pictures better.
Yeah, okay. I like that.
All right, so this is our site. We decided to do a retail center and also a hotel, limited service, Holiday Inn Express. The reason why we went with the hotel is for two reasons. One is Procacci's already building a hotel there, and it's a Hilton brand, and we wanted to give them some diversification in the reservation system. So they have a Hilton reservation system, and now they'll have an ING reservation system. This would be a comparable hotel to the one that's across the street, the Courtyard Marriott. The site supports another hotel or additional rooms. And then our retail is, it's open. We wanted to try to maximize the amount of square footage that we could lease. So we did rooftop parking. And we have examples in Pinecrest, they do this at rooftop parking. I know it's not something that's very common that you see, but we wanted to really like kind of draw people in and make it more walkable. Kind of take another shot at the picture here. And I know they're Christmas trees, but they don't have palm trees.
SketchUp does not have folks.
Can you see them? Okay, so I basically, you know, this is the entrance to the mall, and you can drive in so you can kind of get a feel of what you're seeing. It's not, and maybe you guys can help me out with the right word, it's not premium, but it's not a strip center. So it's like between those two, I don't know what they call it. So we're going to have tenants like, we're looking to get like an H&M, we're looking to get like a Cheesecake Factory type place.
Or mid-market.
Mid-market.
Okay.
And actually not the Cheesecake, because we're trying to attract whoever's not in Dolphin Mall. And, you know, Dolphin Mall, you know, the rents are $80 a foot. Some of the tenants are paying down to 60. But we want everyone that's not there to come over here. And we need a major draw to pull them over there. So, I mean, we have more, in more depth market analysis, I'm hopeful. But basically, there's 36 million people that go to Dolphin Mall, and we're just trying to capture some percentage of that, 2-3%, and it'll make this project viable. So that's the development concept and the financials. I think it's Robert's absolute final.
And I've added a few after that.
Yeah, it's not the absolute final, but
I'll tell you guys this story because I think it's really interesting. I said it to some of you guys. We're at this graduation ceremony yesterday, and Dustin, who's standing next to me, leans over and says, "Hey, I changed some of the numbers again in our project."
Yeah. Well, he wrote a 15-page paper on that financials. So these are some of our assumptions. I'm going to blow it up. We're looking at a triple net rental rate at $26.60, so $38 full service. Our building cost, hard cost, $150, and total development cost, $201.
For the retail?
For the retail, and then the hotel. That, and $25 TI for the first 2 years at the retail. This is our return analysis here for levered and unlevered. That's at 75%, that was a requirement in the case study. Our leasing commission, CPI, which I changed to 3% as we're sitting there because you said that was better, so it really helped with the IRRs. OPEX, even though it's full service, I want to just break it out in the cash flows. I don't know if that's appropriate way to do it, but just to show that what's going to be reimbursable. The land cost in the case study said $12.8 million. I don't know why everyone's getting 14 something. Do you know, you guys find that somewhere? Or?
No, the 14 was our initial, wasn't it? Oh, because we divided the property.
Okay. No, something to maybe look at.
Both groups had the land cost.
I'd be interested, like, if you see anything that looks, you know, out of whack for the hotel, but these are the development costs for the hotel. It's basically $154,000 a room. That FF&E of $10,000.
I think where we got 14.5, if I remember correctly, that's the market rate.
I'm sorry?
The market rate. So when you're putting it as equity, don't you take it as that market rate, not what they paid for it? Or,
yeah, I agree.
So it's worth more. It's actually more valuable. So it helps us with our. That's, I think, where we came up with.
Okay.
But hasn't San Miguel told us that we have to use their cost?
Well, the cost
no,
of the
land. No, no. You'd use a market rate.
Yeah, you would want to use a market rate or equity.
Okay.
Did they give you the market rate?
No, that's what I'm saying. I remember looking at that and seeing it as a market rate. That's why
okay.
I'm getting a 14.5.
So these are our development costs. I also have a 3%. Alex advised us on using 3, so that's why I did the same as the other group on the developer fee, percent and a half, and this has actually changed. This isn't the final, but we have a final, but it's at the office computer. It falls within all the zoning requirements. It includes a pool deck or 40% requirement for open space. We use a 0.75 parking ratio because Dade County, they didn't have any specifics at Sweetwater for the zoning, so we just took the Dade County zoning requirement for that.
So what is that equate to for your hotel?
It's $154,000 a room.
So
parking.
How many per thousand?
Oh, parking. I had 85 parking spots for 114.
0.75 per room. Wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's 85, right here. 85 spots for 112 rooms. In Broward, it's 1-to-1. So I get 114 rooms, I need 114 spaces.
Yeah, I thought it'd be 1-to-1.
Yeah.
Well, I think the arguments they were making in the paper was that it's given that it would be some tourists that maybe would potentially have to be bused in or some other kind of walkability sort of thing they were worried a little bit.
Here's our cash flow as well. So I took a stabilization in year two. I can change the occupancy rates. 75 I thought was kind of like a safe assumption, but Matt said run at 70 out, so I'm going to change it to 70. In talking with people who've developed hotels before, there's not really necessarily a stabilization.
Yeah.
But I just put one in, you know, I don't know if it's necessary or not. So basically, the bottom line is there's about 60% in operating expenses and 40% take-home. And that includes, you know, franchise fee, changing the sheets, 35%. I'm sorry, this is just operating, the direct costs operating. The lights, employees, salaries, and then your unapplied expenses are like your franchise fees and
and some other, you have some other OpEx down here. That's for like GM bonuses and